QI, which tonight is simply sensational. So keep your eyes open, your ears peeled, your nostrils flared, your tongue hanging out, and your hands to yourself as we meet. A sight for sore eyes, it's Jessica Fosterq. A touch of class, Roisin Conaty. A taste of heaven, Aisling Bee. And somehow still here, Alan Davis. And their sounds are a feast for the senses, Jessica goes.
I see trees of green.
Roisin goes.
I hear music, mighty fine music.
Aisling goes.
Oh, yeah.
Can't touch this.
Alan goes.
Oh, I think I smell all right. Oh, I think I smell all right.
Sorry about that. Now, on with the questions. What's the main sense that a typist uses?
Sense of foreboding because you're soon to be unemployed because of the never-ending advancement of technology.
Ooh, that is a very good idea. There are, as I think Alan will know from previous episodes, there are more than five senses. Depends on how you define them. There are sort of between 9 and 26, to be honest. But we are thinking of one called proprioception.
You know the oceptions.
Yes. We're talking...
Ah, proprioception! A lovely man, but a racist.
It's also known as kinesthesia. It's the body's ability to sense its movement and location without looking. So it's why we don't have to look at our feet when we walk, or we don't have to look at the fork when we eat. It allows the body to perform simultaneous actions without stopping to think about each one separately, so you can dribble a basketball while running. And touch typing is achieved through this, through proprioception, knowing where the keys are without looking. So the only thing that you really need in order to get started is, you know, the F and the J have a little raised thing on them, and that tells
you... that's why they're there.
I wondered why they had a nipple.
That's it!
I thought they were the keyboard's boobs.
Jess just texts me like, FJ, 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 FJ. Like, all right, Jess. You really love texting for Jew.
When I was at school, we, all the girls, were taught to touch type and to do speed writing or shorthand. Mm-hmm. And the way we were taught was you had an apron, a black apron, that went over the back of the typewriter and round the back of your neck. And then you had to put your hands in underneath.
I bet all sorts went on under there.
Oh.
More than one used for a space bar.
Yeah.
Well, actually, Ellen, a lot of good novels are written there, so up yours.
I type so much now that I think better by not looking. If you have to handwrite, it takes forever.
Yeah, if you had written a letter recently...
Oh, it's hell.
By the third page, it looked like I was sending it like a death threat. I was just like scrawling. Because literally, I can't. There's no way to sustain this. I just had to end the letter mid. But I was like, things are fine in the end.
You need proprioception, all of us do, in order, for example, to touch your nose with your eyes shut. So if you shut your eyes and try and touch your nose.
No problem.
Nope.
I slowed down when I did it because I genuinely thought I was going way off. I definitely went round the house.
When would you be way off? When is an example of when you would be way off with that?
I've no idea. And it's handy if you're going adrift.
Drunk.
Yeah. It's one of the sobriety tests that are used. There's sort of five standard impairment tests that the police use. Any idea what the other ones are when checking for drink driving?
Walking in one foot in front of the other.
Yeah, so heel toe, walking in a straight line. Standing on one leg is another one, checking the pupils aren't too big or your eyes too watery. And the internal clock test, okay? Oh. So you shut your eyes and see when you think 30 seconds have passed. And if you're piddled, you can't do it.
You fall asleep.
There is a quick way to demonstrate proprioception. So put an arm in the air with the fist clenched, okay, but your thumb sticking out. Close your eyes and grab your thumb with your thumb and forefinger of the other hand.
I, for a second, I thought I could cheat by watching everyone else.
Yeah. Is someone undoing my flies?
Well, I have to get the fun where I can, Alan.
Just looking for the space bar.
Yeah. So it's along with our sense of touch, temperature, pain, movement, it's all part of what's called the somatosensory system. So it's the sensation that can occur anywhere on the body as opposed to in a particular organ like the eye. Have you noticed, though, that the amount people touch each other varies with culture? There was a Canadian psychologist in 1966 called Sidney Jorrad, and he studied couples in coffee bars around the world. And he was both romantic and platonic, same and opposite sex and so on. Couples in Puerto Rico touch each other 180 times an hour, OK? Mm. Couples in Paris, 110 times an hour.
Wow.
London?
Oh, no, it's going to be heartbreaking,
Four,
isn't
one,
it?
One, never.
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 Never. Not at all. No. Absolutely zero. Don't touch her. I don't know. Whoa.
But then there's like creeps who are cultural unto themselves.
Yeah.
And they can be from anywhere. I suppose. Imagine if someone's like, oh, don't worry, I'm just a bit Brazilian.
Yeah.
Just a bit. I feel like I'm in Paris. That's what I'm doing here. I know it's not London, but I'm a Parisian Londoner. Well, okay, if you're a bit Parisian, I suppose, but only because of QI am I letting you do this.
What about, are the Irish more tactile than?
I think we're more hitty, and like this sort of like, stop it. No, seriously, go on. That, stop it. Seriously, like you push and you shove a lot more. And here that comes across as quite aggressive.
Yes.
I think they touch more than the English on the whole.
Yeah, definitely.
Whether it's gentle is a different story. But you'll be piled in together a bit more.
Yeah. Right, moving on. During the Renaissance, who ate better than a king?
Would it be maybe the king's, like, servant or, like, waiter?
Why?
Because I had lots of waiting jobs as a teenager and I ate loads. I ate loads of the stuff off the plate.
You were heading in the right direction, but not quite getting there.
Because they'd have a poison tester. Would a king or queen have
poison
a poison tester?
Yes, it's the poison tester. They would taste everything in Renaissance Europe that the royal had to eat and also large amounts of it, not just a nibble. If it was just a nibble, you wouldn't pick up enough poison. They had to eat spoonfuls from the royal plate.
Yes.
And if it was beautifully intact, say it had a sort of pastry lid or something, they would have to break it open and dip bread into the dishes. By the time the poor royal received their meal, it's probably cold and half-eaten, or demolished, in fact. And then, on top of that, it had to be bland, because strong flavours, of course, would...
What if the poison tester's the poisoner? That's genius!
There's murder.
Oh, the novel writes itself. Yeah.
Constantly making that things look dodgy. I don't know. Oh, if it's like something with rhubarb in it, like, you're fine. Yeah. No, it's poison. Yeah. Rhubarb, eat it.
Or a Brussels sprout.
There was a physician called Ambroise Paré. He was a physician to four kings of France. And he wrote in 1585, anybody afraid of being poisoned should be wary of meats cooked with much art, very sweet, salty, sour, or notably endued with any other taste. So,
was he my Uncle Alan?
I was on holiday in Vietnam, and there's this hotel in Saigon, which was where a lot of the foreign correspondents stayed during the war, and there was so much sickness and food poisoning and general unwellness that they trusted nothing except a bottle of whiskey and a hard-boiled egg. These were the only things that they thought there was no way you can get
nothing,
ill from.
Nothing wrong with that diet.
No, as a basic diet, it's all right.
It's perfectly fine.
Keep you going till lunch.
Yes. My brother and a few friends of mine served as foreign correspondents in Beirut when there was terrible troubles there. And they used to go to the same bar every night, and there was a parrot that learnt to do the sound of incoming missiles. all of the foreign journalists knew this, and the parrot would start to do the sound of an incoming missile, and anybody who'd never been before would diving for cover and getting out of the chairs. It's the parrot.
What a good plot Amazing. Device. It's something to show that someone's like, oh, yes, I've been here 100 times. And they're like, oh, no. And it's like, oh, they didn't know about the parrot.
In Paris time, it was believed that bezoar stones could cure the effects of any poison. Anybody know what a bezoar stone is? There is one.
A badly cooked potato.
Well, it's food-related thing.
Is it? Is it something's turd?
You are the closest. It's an undigested mass found in the digestive system.
Oh, mm.
Bezoam is Persian for antidote or counterpoison, and the theory was that if you had a bezoam stone, it would cure you. So they decided to do a test on this, and they performed an experiment. The same guy, Parry, that I was telling you about, this 16th century physician, he performed an experiment on a cook at the king's court. The cook had been caught stealing some fine silver cutlery, and he was sentenced to death by hanging. So the cook agreed to be poisoned instead, and Parry then used the bezoam stone to cure him. Cook died in agony 7 hours later. Yeah.
Doesn't Wait, no, I'm confused. Is that an old poo?
No, it's undigested stuff from
the
inside.
It's got the makings of a poo, but it never got out.
Yeah.
It's a poo fetus.
It's a... it's a potential poo.
It's a wannabe
it's a
poo.
Poo.
Yeah.
It's not... It's
all a poos are equal under God's eyes. Don't touch it. Wait for it to come out. God intended. Out the back.
Out the back.
They were really valuable. They could be worth 10 times their weight in gold.
But did they have to cut open a person to get them out?
That's the question.
No, I don't think you can go up the back and find it.
Yeah, just have a rummage. I don't think that... It's like...
How did that?
That's more like Bollywood.
It's a bit late to tell me that now, Alan.
How did you talk to someone else?
You've got your evening planned.
They mostly came out of animals like goats and not humans, so...
It's a bit disconcerting that it's sort of nestling in a Moses basket.
Yeah.
We do love them. Now, we were going to get rid of them at one stage, but now we have to say absolutely over the moon with this bezoam stone.
Only a mother could love it.
Royalty would often own several. They would have some of them set as jewellery. Mm. And then not only was the food tested, Queen Elizabeth I's ladies-in-waitings would try on all her clothing in the morning just to make sure that wasn't poisoned as well. I mean, it was a very, very big deal.
Wow. Pulling a bra off and handing it over.
And probably pointless, because most poisons take hours to take effect. Yeah. So you'd really have to wait a bloody long time for seeing if your taster keeled over.
She's probably just trying to plan her outfit as well, though.
Yeah.
Get them. It's nice. Yeah. You like to see it on someone else sometimes. Like, well, it could be poison rather than, like, I want to see what goes.
And turn it around, yeah. Is poison around the back?
Yeah,
I think that's a bit poison looking.
This is Cleopatra trying out poisons on people just to see which ones are, which ones are doing well.
I don't like to call women difficult because I always question it, but I feel like that's a difficult woman thing to do, to try out poisons on people to see what they look like, you know?
I like her fashion sense, though. I think that looks very comfortable. Time now for a sensory demonstration. I'm going to give you a hearing test. OK, let me get out my little keyboard. Oh. Here we go. Now, you should have some whiteboards and some pens there.
Yes.
So, I'm going to play you two notes. You have to write down which is higher or lower, OK? So, I'm going to play this note, don't look, and then this note, higher or lower. OK, so what's everybody got?
Higher.
Higher?
Yeah.
Higher?
Yeah.
Yeah. Yes, it's correct. It's absolutely right.
Oh, God! Good, OK.
OK, fine. So, now we're going to play you some stuff that has been created by a computer, and I'm going to play you three sets, and I want you to write down on each occasion whether the second note is higher or lower. OK, really simple.
Yeah.
Really simple. Did the note go up or did the note go down?
Yes.
Here we go. Up or down?
But we only get one go.
Yeah. Okay, next one. Up or down?
Well, that's very tricky, isn't it?
Yes. I feel like there's more than one note sneaking in there each time. Mm-hmm.
And the third one. Oh, Rashid's very confident with that one. Okay.
Wrong.
Turn all the boards round. Let's have a quick look. So you have got lower, lower, higher. You have basically got lower, higher, higher. Lower, higher, lower. Higher, lower, higher. I mean, they're all different.
Is this gold dress, blue dress, but for the ears?
It is an auditory illusion.
I'd just like to point out that I haven't drawn a cock and balls.
Well done.
Do you want to do it now? Would you feel better?
I think, you know, in terms of children, you'd say this was a developmental milestone.
I'd say that this is a sign of maturity. So, the truth is that what you were listening to, the tones go both up and down. It is called the tritone paradox. So there's two notes effectively being played. It's like C and F sharp at the same time.
Ah.
And then the next note is one in the middle. And the consequence of that is it's both higher and lower, depending
on
which note seemed more prominent. So you are all correct. It doesn't really matter which you put, whether you put up or down or higher or lower. Shall we hear it again? Let's see if you can hear it now.
Huh. I don't like it. So that's your doorbell. Oh, you'd never answer.
It's a bit annoying, isn't it? It's just an illusion, so that it sounds as if, frankly, it could go up and down. But what's most interesting about it was analysed by a music psychologist called Diana Deutsch in 1986, and what she realised is what we hear, whether we hear it going up or whether we hear it going down, very much depends on our culture, on our language.
Oh, my God.
Yeah, the perception is probably going to be the same as your parents. It's probably going to be the same as sort of people in the area that you live. People who have a very much more musical language will hear it differently from people who are rather sort of straightforward with their language. I think it's fascinating. It'll tell you something about people, just whether they say it's higher or lower.
Wow. That's fascinating, even in terms of what makes the sound of a joke, how you play it, the sound of your voice in different cultures. Can you hear a joke happening if you don't understand the language and the rhythm of something, and what cadence works in different cultures? Yeah.
I'd love someone to tell my mum that. I've got a mum who's really desperate to have somebody in our family who's really good at any kind of instrument or anything. Oh. So now I can tell her I am, because I do comedy.
Are you musical, Alan? Not in the slightest.
He's drawn a lovely dick and balls, though. So he is still artistic.
There are other auditory illusions. Have a look at this picture and tell me what you hear.
Oh, isn't that weird?
What can you hear?
I can't hear anything.
Anybody?
No, it's gone.
Not hear anything?
I heard a little bit of wind. Away,
what did you hear, Deli?
I don't know, but I heard noise,
like a thudding.
Yeah, like the landing.
Yeah. So about 70% of people.
I can hear that now. Now I've said it again.
Now you've said it.
And now it's like it's happening.
Yeah.
Because I'm looking at it, I can feel it like it's around me.
About 70% of people who watch this hear a thudding sound when.
Oh, it's horrible because it feels like you're next to it.
Yeah. Yeah, it makes it a bit queasy.
But is it only your eyes telling your brain something that would normally happen because of the movement?
It's completely silent.
And if you close your eyes, there's nothing there.
Yeah, it's totally silent. Right, let's nose around for another question. Here's one. Ooh. Okay, what do banks smell of?
Money.
Money. it depends on the bank, is the truth of it.
Ooh,
it depends on what scent they have decided to associate the bank with.
Bank scent.
Yeah. So it could be grapefruit, could be cardamom, could be chocolate.
I got driven here today in a car by a driver who had an extraordinary amount of aftershave on, and he was playing Smooth FM.
Oh, did he fall in love?
Honestly, I was quite alarmed.
It is always funny to listen to very emotional music with someone you've just met.
Yes.
I've got a late drive home and it's like, we weren't even married. All my own. So I just sat there. So very intense. Both through your own worlds of failed relationships. Yeah. It's like, petrol station. Because I say, shall we? So
when my son was 18, he discovered aftershave. And, oh, dear God. and the whole house would smell of Lynx.
I still get such a visceral, like, sexy feeling around the smell of Lynx. Because for me, it's like being at a disco, age 16, like, Lynx was the smell the people you wanted smelled of. Like, you didn't want to smell something that smelled like a well-to-do.
So he was using the right one at 18.
Yeah. And then you're like...
We're in the world of scent marketing, so environmental scenting. It's the scent that is introduced into a retail or a leisure environment. It's really big business.
Makes you part with your money.
It does, darling. It works because it sends signals to our limbic system, which is the sector of the brain that controls memory and emotion, and it absolutely works. The very first bank to try this was the National Australia Bank headquarters in Melbourne, and they introduced the scent of lime and grapefruit.
Ooh.
In 2012.
They're quite happy scents.
Yes,
happy scents,
yeah.
And some high-end banks, as sort of financial institutions, use signature scents that are supposed to lend a sense of luxury to their clientele.
Very nice.
One bank selected a premium fragrance that begins with mouth-watering mandarin, fresh, watery ozone, and green cardamom notes supported by black pepper and musk.
Oh, that's...
musk!
Musk.
Mm. That's lovely.
I don't want that in a bank. Do you want that in a bank?
I don't want musk in a bank, no. I don't want to get pregnant off the air in a bank.
Well, casinos have found, depending on the scent that they use in the casino, people will gamble more.
Wow.
So the Las Vegas Hilton found that people spent 50% more time playing in the casino if there were floral smells. I like the idea of sort of quite a lot of rough gamblers going, oh, it's nice in here.
Oh, yeah. Into Vegas casinos and people smoking.
It's still smoking.
There. Yeah, in the casino.
I love a casino.
I do. Do you?
Oh, God.
Oh, my God, Sandy. That's the most random fact.
I would never.
She loves a casino. She loves
she
gambling.
She goes in the roulette wheel.
Oh, my God.
I'm going for 4K. Yeah. Wish me luck. It's red, it's red, it's red.
That is so funny.
So Las Vegas, they all have different smells. The Mirage is Polynesian, the Mandalay Bay is Southeast Asian, and the Bellagio, whispers of Northern Italy.
Oh,
I know.
And cigars and cigarette smoke mainly.
Yeah. So scent marketing is a thing. Jewelers, gyms, dentists, funeral parlours, all kinds of people use it now. It's very popular in supermarkets, scent marketing. So in New York, for example, they have fresh bread in the bread aisle, grapefruit in the fruit aisle, that kind of thing. But it's not the only trick that supermarkets play. Some supermarkets use smaller floor tiles in front of the more expensive sections. And the reason is, as you notice the clicking of your trolley wheels is becoming faster, you don't realise it's the tiles becoming smaller, you instinctively slow down. You feel like you've sped up, because you can hear the wheels kind of going like this. You just say, oh, it's going a bit too
any
fast.
Choices our own?
Absolutely nothing.
We spray Lynx, we spray perfume, we're all, like, doing the sale. Like, it's just like... Who are we?
There's an amazing documentary called The Men Who Made Us Sell. It was Sigmund Freud's nephew, I'm pretty sure, kind of made it over in post-World War Germany to America and started using many of the theories about people for selling reasons.
For marketing.
For marketing. Yeah. And one of the big things he did was give... So women's rights had started, because people were like, oh, they should have some. So I'm still not on board yet, but we'll see. And there were all these women marching, and they gave some of them some cigarettes. So then the symbol of, like, a sort of sexy, progressive woman, because they would sell them for pictures and give them to women for free in the marches, that became an iconic kind of image. And that's, they were like, what? And it's the penis and it's a phallus and stuff like that, and just, like...
I was with you till right up until
no,
that
no,
moment.
No, as in, but he would have the thing of going, that whole thing of, like...
It's on fire, the penis.
It's on fire.
If that's any consolation.
No, but seriously, if you burn the tip of a penis, honestly, that man will give you whatever you want.
The guy you're talking about is Edward Bernays.
Edward, yes.
Right. Who is this man, and what do his farts smell like?
Oh.
This show's really gone downhill, I think.
I really like that song. He looks like his farts smell of, like, a church.
Oh. What does a church smell of to you?
Incense and crime.
It's a heady combination.
Rolling tobacco, I imagine he smells of.
His farts smell of chocolate.
Do they?
Ooh. And look how proud he is of
it. I know. Yeah. So he's a French inventor called Christian Poincheval, and in 2017 he invented a pill, which he's showing there, which he claims makes farts smell of chocolate. He told a journalist he'd been eating in a restaurant with friends, and he said, our farts were so smelly, we nearly suffocated. People at the table next to us were not happy. Something had to be done.
Oh. It's nice to hear of a French person that isn't sexy, isn't it?
Just give one to every taxi driver. It's a long journey, just have one of
them. In other fart fragrances, you can also have roses and violets. Most reviewers said that they either made their farts stop smelling entirely or stopped them from farting altogether. And that's because the pills contain active charcoal, basically charcoal with lots of pockets of air in it, and that is known to remove smelly or impure substances.
Is that what we should put around the dog? Some sort of absorbent dome around the dog.
Well, you can get fart-proof underwear.
For dogs?
Wow.
Well, I don't see any reason why a dog couldn't have on a pair of underpants. And there are fart-proof underwear.
Is it like a COVID mask in the bottom of your pants?
Yes. So there's a Colorado psychologist called Buck Weimer, and he invented anti-flatulence underwear as a present for his wife.
Oh.
Who says romance is dead, eh?
His ex-wife.
But I don't see why you couldn't get them for the dog, darling.
I think the dog might feel shamed.
Mm. To be honest with you, I'm not looking to protect the dog's feelings.
Heartproof underpants don't make sense.
Very good.
Absolutely.
Right. This question is not as senseless as it sounds. What kind of dog can tell the time?
I hear music.
A good boy.
A watchdog?
Hey.
I asked for it.
What about a clocker spaniel? There's no original thought left.
Who's got dogs? I've got a dog, you've got a dog, you've got a dog. Well, so have you ever noticed that when you get home, your dog seems to be waiting for you? How does the dog know what time it is?
It waits there all day, surely. Yeah. They're like...
No, definitely not. Definitely they don't do that.
My dog, she would get up and start yelling the place down before the doorbell rang. Mm. She could tell someone was approaching the property.
Sure, they can hear if somebody's approaching the property, but how might they know what time it is?
Well, there's something, and I'm probably going to say this wrong, but there's... When they go to the toilet, they put their bum to the sun, the south, always to the south. I got told this quite recently, and it's maybe if it's QI, cut it if it's wrong. But I think it's... I think it's...
Were you on a show called Gullible?
The more I'm talking on it, the more I'm losing faith in it.
Well, there is some thought that they do prefer to poo along the north-south axis, and it's to do with magnetic fields, but we don't...
We don't know
if that's true or not. So it might be your smell is the thing. So it is not that you stink.
My smell?
No. A human being smell. It's not as you smell as you come up the path or whatever. After you leave the house, your scent lingers and they have phenomenal sense of smell and it decays slowly over the day. If you have a fairly regular schedule, the dog will notice when your smell has declined to a certain level that it associates with you coming home.
Wow.
And then if it disappears completely, it thinks you're dead. And then when you open the door, it acts as if you've come back. Every time you come home. Oh, my God, I thought you were dead! You were definitely dead! It's a miracle!
There's a dog researcher called Alexander Horowitz, and what she did was she tested this thing about the smell by placing several sort of fairly sweaty shirts from the dog's owner around the house before the dog's owner was due to come back, and the dog was not waiting by the door because the smell was still strong in the house, and therefore it didn't think it must be time for the owner to... to be returning. I mean, it could also be if you feed your dog at exactly the same time, or your cats, then they know it's nearly dinner time because they're beginning to get hungry. If you have a dog, is a dog pleased to see your face when you come home?
Yes. My dog, it really is.
My dog levitates when I return. It is... but it seems that the dogs don't really have a part of the brain that specifically responds to faces.
Wow.
So they did a study in Hungary of domesticated dogs, and they showed them videos of either the back or the front of a human head. And, first of all, they preferred dog videos to human videos, and secondly, they didn't seem to care whether it was the back or the front of your head.
Wow.
What part of a human does a dog recognise, then? What part of you is it?
Well, actually, I have to say, this is one of the few times where I would dispute something because I swear that my dog can recognise emotion in my face.
But do you think that's actually your face or that, that dogs can sense feelings more than it's your... They know Sandy's feelings and ups and downs.
It may well be that. I mean, certainly they can read your emotions, I think.
Sometimes you get all three children and the dog all have left the room. He's going off, let's go out. And all in another room like that together. Have you calmed down? Sorry, everyone, sorry.
You know there's a dogs who can now smell tumours or cancer in people.
But you don't want that in your dog. You don't want that. You come in and the dog goes, wow, OK. No, I'm not going to tell you.
The doctor won't tell you.
I'm not telling
you. Do you want to know?
Yeah, I'm not qualified, actually, to give the information.
No, we can absolutely throw the ball. Enjoy life while I can. Yeah. That way.
I mean... Yeah. Let's just enjoy today, shall we? Now it's time for our final sensory demonstration. OK, so, have a look at this.
Whoa.
It looks like a flat window with one end shorter than the other. Mm-hmm. I'm just going to make sure that you guys can see this, like this. Nice. It's called the Ames window. I'm too short to do this sitting down. So I'm going to spin it and just look at the effect that it has
Oh, we don't like
when
it.
When it's spinning. Isn't it interesting? It appears to stop halfway.
It doesn't look like it's spinning all the way around.
Yeah, no. That's the thing. It appears
that
to
is oh. really oh. weird.
I thought yeah. you just weren't doing it.
Yeah,
no,
look
I am
at the
spinning.
Thing. It's not
I thought you were just getting ready to do it.
No, I'm spinning it all the way around, but it appears to stop Whoa. Halfway and go oh. back the other way.
Oh! Oh!
Creep
oh.
Oh.
Oh. Oh. Oh. Oh. Oh. Oh, my God!
Have a look at this. Put a pencil through the window. If you can, you can stick things on or through the window, and then the objects appear to lift
oh my God.
Out of the window.
No way! Oh, my God.
What? That's the absolute Whoa. Please.
Isn't it weird?
So weird.
I know. So it's called the Ames window. It was invented by an American artist and psychologist called Adelbert Ames. And what it is that the brain knows what a window looks like, right? We know what a window looks like. It has equal sides. And they've done this experiment with people who are not used to Western architecture. And all they see is an irregular shape spinning.
We're seeing what we see as a window.
Yeah, it's the same. If you look at these two lines, have a look, and tell me which one is longer.
The top one looks longer.
You think the top one, but I'm sure that's...
The top one looks longer.
But they're the same length.
Yeah, they're exactly the same length. And it's only in the West that we see that the top looks longer. And if you test it on Indigenous people in parts of Angola, the Ivory Coast or so on, they don't see a difference in the length.
There's an amazing book by a chap called Will Storr called The Science of Storytelling. And it's all about, like, our perception of stuff like that and how the first thing you'll see will be the most dangerous version of the thing it could be. Hence why sometimes if you see a shadow at the side of the road that looks like a creepy man leaning into the road, and you realise, then you get closer and realise it's a gatepost. You see the creepy man to protect you in case it is the worst possible thing you have ever imagined before, but only based on the things you've already ever imagined.
But it's very like the auditory illusion that we heard earlier. It depends on what language, what cultural context you've come from, what you'll hear, whether you hear whether the note has gone up or down, whether you think it's shorter or longer. And if you look on the graph there, you can see this is exactly the same.
My brain's still struggling to accept it. I'm counting the squares.
It's fascinating, isn't it? Right, cue lighting.
Ooh.
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 Oh.
Oh.
What does the spotlight effect feel like?
It points out creeps in our presence.
Wow. That's not nice. What does that feel like?
Well, it seems to be the right answer, because the more the light.
What does that feel like to...
I love it.
No, you love it.
It reminds me of being on stage, the only one in the room lit, the only one that can hear...
Go on, Alan.
Dreamland.
Yes, yes, Alan, you heard.
Darling.
It's something that maybe you guys are not the right people to do.
Yeah. No, a bad focus group. I imagine it's supposed to make you feel a bit uncomfortable and self-conscious.
Spotlight effect is the name that psychologists have given to our tendency to dramatically overestimate how much attention people are paying to us.
I don't think so, Sandy.
In 2000, students were asked to wear a bright yellow Barry Manilow T-shirt to a seminar.
In what year, sorry?
In the year 2000.
OK.
And he was, as they said...
It's a really cruel experiment.
It is. He was described as a figure of dubious renown. Oh.
That's on his passport.
I don't know.
Among college students.
Oh, the...
Yeah. Oh. Anyway, afterwards, the wearers of this T-shirt were asked to estimate how many fellow students had noticed that they were wearing this T-shirt, and they overestimated by a factor of two. So it's the spotlight effect. You think that people are looking at you, when, in fact, they're not really.
Well, maybe it means if you feel vulnerable, you can be seen, you're more vulnerable to a predator. You know, if you're in a herd of antelope or something, you're like, oh, I'm the only one they can see.
Yes.
Because you're wearing a Barry Manilow T-shirt. But of course, the cheetah in the long grass doesn't know anything about Barry Manilow. Just trying to find the slowest, weakest one.
I mean, I'm really trying to make the science that I've got match up with what you just said.
Does the spotlight effect always make us think it's something great? Rather than it's something.
No, it's just,
bad.
For example, if you contribute in an argument, in a group discussion, people almost always overestimate the extent to which others have noted their contributions. And now I have a horrible sense of foreboding that it's about to be general ignorance. Yes, it is! Ooh. Fingers on buzzers, please. Which composer was completely deaf by the time of their final work?
Beethoven.
Beethoven is the one that we most think. He has always thought to have been deaf at the end of his life. It is popularly believed that he wrote the Ninth and Final Symphony, 1824, and that he couldn't really hear it. Now, we know his hearing did deteriorate, but there is some... I love that there is still research happening, and all these years later, we might decide to change our minds about it. He carried around something called conversation books when his hearing deteriorated, in which his companions could scribble their side of the conversation. He also used them as a sort of diary, writing reminders, shopping lists, like any other human being. And there's a musicologist at the Kent State University in Ohio called Theodore Albrecht, and he has spent decades translating these conversation books into English and found 23 references to Beethoven's hearing in the composer's writing around this time. So, for example, in 1823, Beethoven wrote, "Baths and country air could improve many things. Just do not use mechanical devices, ear trumpets, too early. By abstaining from using them, I have fairly preserved my left ear this way." And that is only a year before the Ninth Symphony. So it's possible that we just were wrong. Not only, according to Professor Albrecht, was Beethoven not completely deaf at the premiere of his Ninth Symphony, he could hear, although increasingly faintly, for at least 2 years afterwards.
I love that we're like, you weren't that good. You were only barely deaf.
You had your left ear, Beethoven. That's, had your left.
Yeah, that's the most Irish you'll ever be. But I heard he wasn't that deaf-like.
Gabriel Fauré, we could have gone for, or Ralph Vaughan Williams. Sadly, deafness caused by the guns of World War I.
Sorry?
I totally fell for it.
You like that?
Yeah, I remember it. my dad here.
Beethoven could probably hear the cheers for his final symphony. What did people in the Middle Ages do with their excrement?
Trees of green.
Look for magical stones in it.
Yes. Bezoars.
And but then throw it out the window.
But there's a picture of someone throwing it out the window.
Well, this is actually an anecdote about King Louis IX of France. And a student poured his pot, as it were, out onto the king. And you would have thought the king would be furious, but the king, in fact, gave him a prebendary, which is a remunerative post in a cathedral, because he was so thrilled to see a young person up early and going about their studies. So you were not supposed to throw your excrement out of the window. Apart from anything else, everybody knew that human waste spread disease. So they did not tip it into the street, they poured it into the nearest river, and the rules were people were responsible for the cleanliness of the streets outside their own houses. In the 1300s, there was one man who was beaten to death for dropping eel skins on the street, and the other people didn't want to have to pay the fine. And larger houses had latrines, and then they had something called a gong farmer, somebody who came and emptied the latrine. There we are, they're taking it off. And towns usually provided public latrines. They were known as places of easement.
Place of easement.
Those two lads.
Yeah.
Like, I'm doing a QI, which is a beloved television show, and I have not even dressed up as well as those two lads going to empty the jacks. Like, that is bowler hats, waistcoat, whole shebang. You're probably going to get shit in you. Absolutely.
Gong farmers.
Hats off to the gong farmers.
If you found something in the shit, somebody had dropped coins, whatever, you got to keep it.
Yes,
that's
lovely.
Nice.
I thought you were going to say, like, they did, like, tea readings with poo. Some sort of, like,
Where does the word loo come from?
Short for Lulu.
I mean, technically, that is correct. It is short for Lulu.
Short for lavatory.
No, so the story used to be that loo came from the phrase garde-loo, meaning watch out for the water, that people would shout as they emptied their chamber pot into the street below. Cannot be the case because, first of all, they didn't do that.
Didn't do it.
And secondly, the first recorded use of the word loo comes from 1922 in James Joyce's Ulysses. It's probably from Waterloo, which was a company that made iron cisterns in the 20th century.
Ah, wow.
That's where loo from. The notion that people emptied their chamber pots out of the window is a load of... anyway, moving on. where does the ukulele come from?
The ukulele case.
It comes from annoying people at house parties.
Yes. And these are all truisms.
Colombia.
Ireland.
Ireland?
No. We'd never do that.
I like that you're going like this. Ireland.
I was so impressed with myself, and then I realised I was wrong, and I thought, just hold it. Just hold it.
Just hold it. Is it Honolulu?
Oh, what state is that in?
Hawaii. I'm not going to tell you, Sandy,
you say Hawaii?
Because I don't want to patronise
you. Hawaii.
Okay, Hawaii.
Hawaii.
That's terrible. horrible.
It was invented in Madeira, which is a Portuguese island off the coast of...
That's not fair, because they set us up with a gentleman's shirt, the little hummingbird, the flower...
That is because it is associated with Hawaii. It was first brought to Hawaii by a migrant Portuguese worker named João Fernandes in 1879, and it's originally called Braguinha, which is a Portuguese word for it. It was the Hawaiians who renamed it ukulele, and it translates as jumping flea after the way the fingers kind of leap about on the fingerboard. Right. At what time of day are you most likely to hear a cock crowing?
Oh. As soon as I bat my eyelashes. How do they know?
They are, people think, famous for crowing at first light of day. Actually, they crow all bloody day, sometimes at night as well. They do often crow at or just before dawn, but basically they then keep going.
So, in the olden days...
The olden days?
Exactly the type of historical accuracy people are watching QI for. when farmers were all reliant on the cock crowing to know when to get up, were they all just up all the time, just having the occasional like, hour-long nap like newborn babies? They're just getting dressed 18 times a day.
The interesting thing is that they seem to know it's dawn not because it's light, but because their internal body clock tells them. So they've done tests where they've kept them in sort of dimly lit rooms and they still start crowing at exactly the same time each day. So you can rely on them to wake you. It's perfectly fine.
It's one of the few creatures that could swallow its own brain.
What?
What?
Look at the size of its mouth. Its brain has got to get into that tiny head.
Oh, if you fed it,
got it out,
brain.
It could eat its own brain.
Anyway, they're not crowing because it's light. They're crowing for all sorts of reasons. Warnings, territorial claims, showing dominance, tell other cocks they've just mated. Woo! You know. Their crows are really, really loud. It's an average of 100 decibels if you're standing within a few feet. That's about the same as a chainsaw. Or it could be as much as 143 decibels. So human eardrums rupture at 150 decibels. So why don't cockerels deafen themselves?
Haven't got any ears.
No.
Oh, actually, why would they be bothering telling their mates about the
sound? Why would they bother?
Jess's head is like Sherlock now, but of course.
Yeah, this is shrinking my brain to the point where I could eat it.
they have an inbuilt system to prevent their hearing getting damaged. It is amazing. Half of the bird's eardrum is covered by a bit of soft tissue that dampens the noise. And also, when they tilt their head back to crow, another bit of material covers the ear canal completely and serves as a built-in ear defender.
Oh, so a little bit of minor surgery and they shut up.
Yeah. Well,
the bit nobody talks about is why haven't the hens gone deaf?
Oh, oh they're all in the corner.
shut it. Shut it. If you hear a cock crow, it might be morning. Or he might have just got lucky. Let's hear the scores and see if they feel smelly or tasty. In last place, with a sense of shame, frankly, with minus 36. Ashley.
No, what? I smell a rat. I smell a rat.
With a sense of humour in joint second place with minus 18, it's Roisin and Jessica. And with a sense of purpose with minus 7, it's Alan. Roisin, Aisling, Jessica and Alan. I leave you with this sign-off from Steve Martin about his sense of smell. I cannot smell mothballs because it's so difficult to get their little legs apart. <Good night>.